I have to say, Paul, you look dashing tonight. Never convict your client looking at you.
I'll show you some pictures.
If you wanna see them.
Are you doing tomorrow? Clock, and it's always.
Where did you go?
California.
It being 7 o'clock, we'll call the meeting to order at this time. Start with an introduction to the board.
Out of town, Bob Hesselbein, Kurt Trubusky, Paul Mann, South Park Region, Superintendent Mary Wolf, Ashley, John Howard, Paul Smith.
Yep.
Aye.
Citizen comments. Also, a great conversation was. Also, we had a chance to go back to the high school. So, there was a storage connection in this report. There's some tougher questions. There were valid questions. Tougher crowd, but questions were answered as well as good answers for the questions that were asked. So, I've had several conversations with probably the people who are starting to do lots of things. Early on, they brought that up.
And if I can piggyback on that, I just remind you that we did all that.
Right.
I
thought the. Role playing exercises so that they mill about in the middle of the classroom and then the teacher gives them a
forgot what night it was.
We're competing.
If I could, before the meeting here, George.
Presta Giacomo.
Presta Giacomo, Cam.
Andy Warren.
Initiator proposal to have the board consider a student or. George and Dr. Mike would be working with the students on developing proposals. Question about, but if it's brought to the agenda committee, the agenda committee will, make a decision or allowance or following. So, work with Dr. Mike and George on the proposals that are going to make some sense. And we'll see what we can do and if we're interested in serving.
Yeah, Ann does have a proposal. Ann does have a proposal of something else I want you to talk to me about. I think Ann wants to be, we're gonna have a legislative.
Yeah, it's related in, or is it related to the,
Credits options when everyone went through course options and then went course credits and the law changed like two times and then the while that we had to pay and then the university had to pay. Now, part of it is licensure. We're still hung up where if you want to offer course options where kids are getting credit, they have to have a master's degree in the field, not in the field, but in that area. Like, some sort of a science credit, say chemistry, they have to have a master's in chemistry. They can't have a master's in teaching. And so, there's a proposal that's going around the state to tweak the law to make it a little bit It's great to have a law that allows these dual credit options, but if you can't get teachers to teach them, then nobody's getting them. And we're lucky, we're in Dade County. This proposal is really a lot for more rural schools that you can't find people. So that's what she wants to talk about.
Yeah. So it'll be that and they'll be realistic, be a special ed funding resolution.
Across and more board matter versus political matter. So it would be something to take a look at in the next 4 or 6 weeks or whatever. So again,
Thursday is our second professional development day of the year. We have a variety of learnings going on across the district. So traditional Thursday and Friday. Friday is just a non-school day. And then we will complete all of our referendum presentations by the end of next week. But there are a couple that I want to add that weren't in the update on Friday that I think you may be interested in. One is a week from tonight, on the 29th at 7 p.m. That's with the Village of Cross Plains, Village Board. So again, 1 week from tonight at 7 p.m., 10:29. And then I'll send out a reminder email. And also, if you have mornings available and you are interested, November 1st, it's a Thursday morning at 7:30. I will be doing a presentation to Get Moving Middleton for the Chamber of Commerce. That's at the Hilton Garden Inn. And we usually have about 180 to 200 attendants. So I know, Pat, at one point you said you might get all that. Again, I will put an email out, but I just thought I would make those public tonight. And that's it. We're getting close, Perry. We're getting close.
So we've got both upcoming events and referendum taken care of.
Yes.
Nicely done.
Thank you.
We're going to move over to consent. Offer up for your approval, administrative business services, approval of bills payable.
So move. Second.
Discussion, school, trailers and buses, bizarre buses.
When the middle schools do it, they always sit next to each other and do it side by side, so, yeah.
So, really quick, in your information that was sent to you tonight, as promised, two weeks ago, I did a board report around the ESS system that we are putting in place this year. And what I wanted to bring tonight is to give you a quick look of the district's overall data around our new STAR assessment, as well as our number one assessment for the district. So when you look at this document, you will see that it says urgent intervention on watch, and at all of the district. What I want to read to you really quick is just what does each of those really mean, so you kind of have an idea as you look at urgent intervention on watch and above benchmark, because the principals, when they come to you with their report, they're going to show you some data and talk to you about data on that level, so that you're on the same term for language. And so, just so you know, the urgent intervention, our students are below the benchmark score. Then there is the intervention, which is students below the benchmark score, and off watch, which means students slightly below the benchmark score. And then at or above benchmark, our students meeting or exceeding the benchmark score. So I wanted to give you that language so that you understand exactly what that means when you hear our principals working on those things, when you hear teachers talking about, we have a number of students who are, you know, in urgent intervention, and intervention, I don't know what they're referencing. So this particular document, like I said, is overall district's view. Laura and I had some great, Dr. Love, had some great conversations around how we want you to kind of see this. You will see it. This is the first time this year. The one thing that is missing is the freedom of use that will be added in terms of showing you the data across the board as well. That we had for the next one, I think the next one is in like maybe December. So you'll get one of these again in December, and then we'll give you another one as we move around the year. So you can kind of see the growth of the year for the district as a whole, because you're going to be getting reports from the schools throughout the year. So I'll give you the picture of the district, then you'll give you the picture of the schools, so you kind of have a sense of how the district is going.
Individual who had expressed a concern about the disparity of male versus female in some of the advanced placement classes transitioning from elementary to middle school. And obviously as a board we can't answer that question, but it did bring up a question and that night talked about a little bit. It was possibly getting data for us to see if there's a male-female disparity, which I see you have that here, but I'm not sure if we can, you know, how we can look at that as, you know, something for us to be evaluating. And I don't know if there's a performance difference, significant difference inside.
So I want to give you an answer to that. I want to make sure she got that opportunity to share that, and also make sure that she has kind of support question to kind of make sure that you know, give you something.
Great, Beth will be here for state report cards on That's what the letter referred to?
That's what the letter referred to, but...
Because that's the only time that we have an acceleration. We don't accelerate in any other the subject areas.
Yep, and just need to help them understand that.
Yep.
And just to give you a little context,
when you take a look at who's in the classes, it seems to be skewed, and we're curious if maybe invitations are going out and choices are just being made and they're not participating, or just
They're not going to be able to access that content unless they're reading at grade level. And so just the, like, the key, if I was going to talk about, like, the big buckets and big rocks that we're doing at West Middleton, which, as a side note, most of the other schools are doing, like, yeah. I mean, Chris is going to end up probably just mirroring what I said. And what's super cool about that, like, this is my third year in the district, and responsive classroom is something that I've talked about before. That's something I've been trained in. I know that it works. It's important to me. When I came on, West Middleton had some staff who were doing that. And now that's a district initiative, right? And so it's a three-year piece where people are getting trained and are buying in. So we're continuing with that work. And so our steps are around, like, one of the big components is that you have a morning meeting every morning. But it's not just like, oh, just meet in a circle and talk. There's actual, like, research based around the different components and why you do different things and how you tie it back to the curriculum, which that's the cool part. Like, it's not just like, oh, we're going to sit and, but, like, we can look at what are we teaching kids and how can we bring that into these community pieces. So we're working on those components and tying that back to the curriculum. The other piece for staff is really around developing our whole school as a professional learning community so that we know that we're better together, that we learn better together through each other, and then I know you're doing some amazing things and I might be struggling with this group of kids and you might have some really great strategies and tools that can help me. So we are putting lots of different structures in place and opportunities for teachers to be sharing and growing together. So that's a huge one. And then for us, as far as family engagement, you all know that is, like, a huge piece for us. And it's one of the things I shared in our little round table is we had our fall dance this year, and our school counselor, who's been at West Middleton for probably 6 or so years, it really, if you looked, it was a snapshot of our demographics. So we had our families from all of our neighborhoods, including the Alver Park neighborhood, and even though we provided transportation, she said, we provided transportation 3 or 4 years ago. They're here because they feel like they belong here and they're comfortable. And, you know, and so, like, that's a shift. And so there's many things that we're doing that we're continuing to do. The big thing I keep talking about this year is two-way communication. A lot of times with school, it tends to be one-way communication. Mm-hmm. We're going to tell you what we're doing. We'll tell you what the curriculum is. But we're trying to have this two-way communication and knowing that some parents, you know, like, just many different ways that we can reach as many different parents as possible.
So. Ditto.
And
well, and this is just a really exciting time with all of us really coming together. And I'm guessing the other groups heard this in the roundtable, but this feels like a repeat of what our roundtable was, that the staff that were there, the teachers that were in there, were talking about PLCs and building that teacher capacity through that professional learning. And they were also talking about the social emotional needs, and we're addressing those on in a really uniform way, and are able to access amazing professional development because all of the schools are working together. We're working as a district, and it's not just pockets of good things happening, it's collectively good things happening around the district. Very deliberate, what Katrina had talked about with the morning meeting, things are very intentional, they're very deliberate, and that it's not just every classroom's doing the same type of grading or the same type of activities. You're tailoring that for what your classroom needs. So there's a lot of continued PD around that. On Thursday, we'll be dipping into teacher language and as a school, really talking about the language we use. We'll just be touching on that. That will be something that will continue through February and our April PD. And I think that the piece that people are really understanding is that we only have so much time with our kids during the day. And that time needs to be engaging, and it needs to be very deliberate. And it can also be very fun and joyful. So it's really being thoughtful on how we bring that together for our students. and how we grow as professionals while we're doing that. So the same types of goals around social emotional learning, around building PLCs and that two-way communication with staff or with parents.
Katrina, one observation.
Sure.
In fact, the last year when I was at your school, we had to kind of introduce me to the response.
Yeah, yeah.
So very intrigued about the things that I've been working on. Just I'm very happy with it. Sounds like the feedback that we've been both in a little bit around here and across all of us. It's been a lot of good positive feedback that some of the teachers always like it a lot. And you're right, it seemed like a small thing. To see this continues to go positive. And the other question I have for you, though, is I haven't had a chance to answer my email yet, but it's fast.
Great.
No, it was just in reference to, you can touch a little bit on family.
Mm-hmm.
Talk about that on my roundtable as well. And so it sounds like either the PAC or some other community knows some feedback
yep.
you've gotten from parents. I was just curious, what specific feedback have the parents given?
And you're like specifically talking about our families who live in the Oliver Park neighborhood? Yeah. So what's interesting is like if I think back about some of our meetings, you know, we talked about like what would you like to have at school, and a lot of it was like fun stuff. Like, do Zumba that I can come with my kid, which is like, I just wouldn't have thought about that, right? And it was a lot more fun ideas that weren't necessarily like a big school dance, but like, you know, something that maybe like a group of people could do together. I have one of our families really was like, could we like try to get together like some soccer matches, like teachers and parents kind of, and you know, like get the kids excited. My kids would love to see us play soccer against you. So that was honestly like not in, you know, because typically schools are like, we got to have a literacy night. And you know, because a lot of parents, the feedback we get from a lot of parents too is like, what are you doing, what are you teaching with my kid, and what should I do with them at home? That's information that lots of families want too, but they're also like, we want some more chill ways that we can like interact with our kids in the school setting. So that's some feedback that we got.
Small.
Yeah, like the dance is fun, and it is super fun. But what are just some ways too that I can come with my kid and have a fun experience with school, and I think with teachers too, like that's, which is always really hard, right? Because like teachers are, they're doing a bazillion things, but I will say like if staff would, that is one thing with West Middleton staff is they really do make a concerted effort to go to our things like the barbecue at the Oliver Park, you know, neighborhood center, and it's huge. Like a lot of our teachers were able to meet some families ahead of time and make those connections before the school year even started. And that's pretty invaluable.
Well,
so.
That sounds good. The question around there was on your kindergarten, which you were talking about relationships.
Yeah.
How you can
mm-hmm.
do behavioral intervention stuff or social emotional learning, unless they trust you in a relationship. Well, you know, while some of the stuff sounds like a flaw, but opportunities to build relationships.
I think the other thing that the feedback that we got is we want to trust you, right? Like, we need to know that you have our kids' best interest at heart. And I have parents who, like, there's whether it's myself or other staff who've worked very intentionally to build a relationship so that when there are issues, that neither of us are jumping to conclusions and we're like, okay, I'll have a conversation with you versus I'm going to get mad. And, you know, and it's like, and I've had feedback, direct feedback that says, it's only because I like you that I'm going to listen to what you're saying, you know, and I'm like, that's cool. I worked at it, right? You know, but then that pays off when situations do arise. Because they know that you see them and you know who they are as a person. Yeah. And our parents want the same thing. So. Mm-hmm.
And I just want to add, because I usually come with a separate AGR goal, but this goal addresses our students that qualify for free and reduced lunch as well. So it'll serve as the same goal.
First of all, I want to say I'm pretty good for the board. I see what both of the top girls have been probably their most challenging schools in terms of diversity of population. So the fact, first of all, if you have a parent reaching out to you wanting to try and find this establish a trust relationship, obviously the things that you're doing, you reached out to them, now they're reaching back. And I think that's a very positive sign. One, I commend you on that particular action. Because for years, plus Middleton has just been a public transit population, students with high needs, as well as high diversity in terms of both socioeconomic classes, parents with different needs and different classes inside. The fact that you're having a sub-parent who reaches out saying, this one is one that wants to feel comfortable with the one across you. That's, we haven't had that before. I just want to say that.
Yeah. Well, and it's not just me. I mean, I even think about when new families come in, my social worker, my counselor, they are doing like such a nice job of making those connections right away and really just going beyond, oh, here's a tour. And I think that's huge. It's like they talk about customer service, right? Like how you set things up in the beginning is huge. Because if you do have to make that first call of like this happened or whatnot, they already feel like okay, I met you and you're okay. So.
Mm-hmm. And Title I does have a requirement for family engagement, mm-hmm. So I know it's also a big piece of SOC Trail, and yep. So maybe Chris, you can also share what SOC Trail is doing, because both of these schools are just absolute leaders in terms of reaching out to families and bringing them together. So.
I did want to leave you out of that conversation.
Oh, no.
I just started talking.
So,
that's good.
A very good job as well, but I'll let you.
Mm-hmm. And we're just starting to experiment with a different type of parent-teacher conference as well. Our two tweak classrooms in kindergarten and first grade are doing parent-teacher teams. So conferences will be trying to get that two-way communication. So it will be different groups, like about eight families coming in a group and meeting with both teachers at the same time. So it's trying to figure out how we can meet those needs of having it be more two-way, being able to get the curriculum, and being able to ask questions and know how to support. So that's one piece that we're, as TWE moves through, it's a way to accommodate classes of, because there's like 36 kids between the two classrooms and both teachers are a part of the conferences, so it's a way to accommodate that. And a way that we want to move. So it doesn't seem so daunting when another group has already tried it for another group to pick it up. We've traditionally been doing different types of parent engagement nights where families come together. Like you said, what we found through the years isn't the literacy nights or the more academic nights. It's let me do something fun that involves learning with my kids, not separate from my kids, but with my kids. So grade levels have chosen different activities for that grade level, and we've done anything from an egg drop to different ways of like poetry and acting things out. And so just a variety of different ways that we've tried to engage kids and families together and had really good response from that.
Is just a really good thing if you're doing a great service.
course, he was here for the equity presentation. He gave us a speech, but it was a piece written by James Baldwin. Mm-hmm. And he, one of the points that he often makes is that the kids don't feel like they belong. So I asked him, you know, does everyone feel like they belong in our schools? Mm-hmm. And he said, we're getting there. Mm-hmm. Mm-hmm. But you said, you know, they felt like they belonged at the school, and that's part of the dance. And I know I mentioned this at our round table, but, you know, I expect that engagement that you're building out will just, you know, will pay dividends as they progress through the school, so they should take them to high school. I mean, that's how it's exactly, you know, when we set those board goals of engagement, that's exactly it in action,
mm-hmm.
right?
Mm-hmm.
In their schools, or engaged in their learning, both on the student and family side, and as they progress through the school, and as we kind of set that expectation at your two schools mm-hmm. and on the others, and that's how we look at the whole district, right?
And I think at an elementary level, like, I feel like we have a responsibility to you're not going to love all your teachers. It's just not going to happen because we're human beings, right? But, like, for you to have a couple of really key experiences where you connect and you feel like that teacher sees me and they know me and they see me as a parent, because then I can build on that. But if I don't get that experience in elementary and then I go to middle, where it's just, you know, by the nature of middle school, it's you have more teachers. So I think that's, we just have a responsibility to continue to make those connections so that families have things to build on as they move into a bigger system.
But I'd say what the board did was they funded positions that could allow that to happen,
mm-hmm.
you know, and that's where the hard work comes in for the building.
Right.
So the board's support with giving the resources
mm-hmm.
to do that. So.
100%. And then I think the other part is I will give credit to the teachers, too,
mm-hmm.
because I'm telling you, like, they didn't get paid to go to the barbecue or to go do the donuts in the morning. And so many people just go because it's, you know, it's important to them. And I think that in both of our buildings, that the, like, equity work that is living inside of people versus, like, oh, it's something I have to do. Like, nobody's going to get up and go to the bus stop at 6:45 in the morning unless they really feel it and they know how important it is. And so if I had to bribe people or whatever, it wouldn't, the parents would know that was disingenuous, right? I mean, but so that's, like, the people who work in our buildings are phenomenal, and they know that, like, I have to make these connections. Like, if our job is to move these kids, I got to get connected with them and their families, so.
Mm-hmm.
That's one of our things from the board. Obviously, it's a lot more work to do, but it certainly would be in the right direction. Training that gives us the criteria is obviously, it's a lot of things to do, but it certainly would be in the direction of our work.
Thank you. As you all know, I think you maybe already did, but STAR is a computer generated assessment. You place them in the map and go to the record of that.
Yeah.
And Rainey said it's a fall winter spring, so it's 3 times a year. And to see the percentages moving kids from urgent intervention to intervention, from intervention to on watch, and then from on watch to intervention.
Mm-hmm.
We'll see those numbers move as the year goes on.
Yeah.
And I'll say it is a fall, winter, spring, but it's also an assessment that we can use at any given time to give us more data around what we want to know from kids. So we can give it this week, we can give it 2 weeks later to kind of give us some more information around how kids are growing and changing within their learning and that kind of thing. So the accessibility of it and the usage of it is a lot different than the map. Map was, I think, about 45, 50 minutes. This is anywhere from 15 to 20 to maybe 30 minutes at that. So it definitely helps us get the data that we want a little faster.
Before you guys take off, as a board, I talked a little bit about Bill in terms of that. But please get in, honestly, get in, moving forward. This is new for the board, I'm moving forward as well. I see this as a great tool, but obviously,
mm-hmm. Absolutely.
And I just will give a huge thanks for, what we call it, the annex, our outbuilding, or the man cave, because we have two guy teachers out there. And our parking lot is like, so that's, we have winter tea, you know, and harvest lunch coming up, so I'm sure we'll still have to park a little bit on Mineral Point or over at the garden, but like, that's, it's fabulous, so it's been great. Yeah.
Sure.
Yeah, you got to see it. Like, yeah, come over. The kids, they love it. They feel so special to be out there. It's really cool. Yeah, yeah. Well, that's don't put that in the. It's called the annex, but it's two of our male fourth grade teachers are out there. So somebody once made that a joke. I was like, that's great. That's. Or like we could call it the she shed if it was two, you know, that's the other, if it was two gals out there, but yeah, so it's good. Thank you guys.
Thank you.
We don't know who those students are. I can't even tell you where they attend. All I can tell you is that DPI shares with us a number, and then we are allowed an exemption on the revenue limit in the amount of the tuition that we need to pay for those students, and then we turn around and pay it. So in essence, there is a zero impact on internally within the district. Where the impact is on our community members, because that amount goes on to the tax levy, and then it's paid out strictly for the private voucher. This year, that amount for tuition was about $52,000.
So, just for clarification, so I understand what you're explaining correctly, means that the cost of those 15 kids that are in the private school is then being
distributed across all the taxpayers.
And then the levy is increased because of that, the pay for them going to private school.
Correct. We also, for the first time this year, have a special needs voucher student. And so that amount, there's just one student, is about $12,500. And the funding works the same way. We're allowed to increase our revenue limit. That amount is taxed across everything, you know, all of our value. We turn around and make the tuition payment. So our essentially expenses and our revenues internally are the same, but there is an impact for our taxpayers. New this year is what's called an independent charter school. An independent charter school is a school that essentially is a district amongst themselves. Anybody can go to those schools as long as they meet, well, and most of the time they don't really have eligibility requirements. It's similar to like a public school district. A person can choose to go there, or a student can choose to go there. We have 5.8 students that are attending what they call a 2X charter school, and I think 2X is just related to the statute. The two schools that happen to be in Dade County, specifically in Madison, are the Isthmus Montessori Academy and the One City Senior Preschool. And both of those independent charter schools are authorized by the UW, their Office of Educational Opportunity. But how those, how that is funded is that this one is different than the other ones. This one, we actually include them in our resident count, in our revenue limit, and then we receive the revenue limit authority, and then we turn around and pay the tuition. Why we have different funding sources for those different, I don't know, that's just the way it is right now. But what is different and maybe significant, and just for your board information, is that this isn't an equal revenue and expenditure. Because when you think about the revenue limit, it's a three-year rolling average. So even though we have our count increase this year by 5.8, we only receive a third of the funding in a revenue limit. So just between $10,000 and $11,000 is what we receive per student in the revenue limit. So about a third of that we're receiving from those FTEs. So, and the tuition that we're paying out this year is almost $50,000. So there is a...
The total for all three students or per student?
The almost $50,000 is for the 5.8.
Mm-hmm. And that one is not a wash.
That is not a wash. No. It would take 3 years of that same enrollment for us to feel the full effect in our revenue limit, where it would be a closer wash for the expenditures and revenues.
Is that assuming that those students are removed to the district?
No. No. They very well could have been students that were attending that school before. It's just now that there's a funding mechanism. We don't know who those students are.
It's the funding, I don't know who you guys can talk later. But, you know, when you talk about one third, that's assuming that they're a student one day, or they're a dish on their city, or a student inside their body for 5 years. And they
don't know right. And, but we don't know who those students are, so.
Right. So let's just say on one side, the worst case would be that they'd be new students for correct. One third, but they've been existing students for more than 3 years, then it would be not quite a wash.
Correct. Correct. So that's just kind of some new things or just some areas I wanted to highlight in terms of the impact of the most recent laws as it relates to private school vouchers, special needs vouchers, and now the independent charter schools. On a really great positive note, our state aid went up about 24% to 25%. And we knew it was going to go up. I mean, we predicted in our preliminary budget report that it would be around 17% to 18% that it would go up. But when all the numbers shake out, not just with our district, but for all districts, because remember, it's one pot of money, and all the factors that everybody's experienced is how the pot is distributed, we actually saw an increase of closer to 24.5%. And when you take and factor that in, when you think about the revenue limit is a combination of your state aid, your computer, and well, not your great state aid, and taxes. And so if you receive more aid, your taxes are going to go down. And that's what we saw happen. We're actually experiencing a 1.82% decrease in our tax levy a month this year. So it's not even, I'm not talking mill rate, I'm talking purely the amount that we're taxing. So that,
and that's after we start to pay off our last referendum.
We've been paying interest on that.
Right, right. There's been some screens and there's been concerns that because we already have one referendum, the taxes will continue to go up and up and up. but this year we're actually having a decrease in what we're total number we're attaching to the municipalities.
Correct.
For their portion of the tax burden.
Correct. So that's been a really positive note. And then as soon as you see, well, and then on top of having a decrease in what we're levying, we also saw 5.65% in our value across the district. So the combination of those two actually is causing our mill rate to drop down to 9.59. So when we looked at last year, it was 10.32. We're down to 9.59 right now, which is a pretty, that's a 73-cent drop. So that's pretty amazing. About a 7% decrease in our mill rate. So those are some of the highlights of what we're looking at for in terms of a budget and the associated tax and mill rate impact. Throughout the rest of the document, very similar to what you've seen before, it's just been updated. But I have two things that I just want to share with you because Kurt Karbuski is one of the best proofreaders I've ever met in my entire life. I might have to contract this person out. So this will get updated in the portal just so that you have it in case you refer back to it. But there are actually changes that aren't reflected in our current year. In the tax levy history folder, or in graph, the percentage change from 2016-17 was incorrect. So I've updated that in terms of what the impact was from 2015-16 to 2016-17. And if you're actually looking in detail on the document as the standard report from DPI, we have what's called a PILT program, Payment in Lieu of Taxes. And it comes from the DNR because we have property located within the district that's DNR owned, that's not, so we can't tax it, but we receive a payment in lieu of taxes. But if you look at the typing, it says DNR pilot. And of course, who knew what a DNR pilot was? So those are two changes that I've made in the document that will get updated in the portal for you. Otherwise, is there any specific questions about the budget or the tax levy information that I provided?
I have a question. When we were here for our annual meeting and went through all the information, was the mill rate that we passed that night 9.59?
No, it was 9.98.
That's what I was thinking, that it's higher since all the numbers have come in based on the ground.
Yeah, we went from 10.32 last year to estimating 9.98 in the preliminary annual meeting budget. And then because our aid came in even better, we went from 9.98 down to 9.59.
Yeah, I thought it was 9 something. I just wasn't sure if it was 9.59.
Yep.
Thank you.
In years past, just from a board perspective, we had budgets which were very changed, not a lot of changes, but we, because of that time, received a reduction in state aid, and then our portion of the taxes that went to municipalities increased because we had a reduction in state aid. The increase of the taxes went up more to do with the decrease in state aid than it did with our increases. Happening. So right now we're on the other side of that point, where we are seeing a larger increase in state aid. And at this particular point in time, the taxpayer can look at the school district and say thank you, when the reality was a lot of this had to do with our increase in our state aid.
The biggest impact right now in our aid is coming from the fact that we are growing so much.
Right.
So while we have incredible growth, 5.65%, I mean, there's going to be a lot of districts that would be really envious of having that kind of an increase in our value. Having said that, that increase in our value is not offsetting that high enrollment that we're having. So on a property, you know, like a value per member, we look more property poor than we used to. So, you know, if we continue to see these large enrollment increases and our value stays similar to what it is right now, I don't expect us to have extreme drops in aid. You know, I would say at some point it's probably going to level out more so than it is going to be to increase. But the helpful thing is because we're increasing at a greater rate than what our property value is going up, so we look at the property for and more and more.
Yes. Sorry.
What we're adding to the presentation, some of these charts and information. And if you're very open out there, Facebook and Twitter and whatever else you do, just that, you know, so that people do know that the actual dollar amount. So if you have the tax levy comparison chart for a $422,000 home, it's actually going down to $1. Not just a percentage or small years. So that's the information about that.
So we'll move on to A for resolution.
Or did you want to move that?
This is for the budget and the certification, so we can pass that action that will be. So every year, we do a cash flow borrowing to help with our payroll and operating. Because as we enter late November, in December, and then up until the first payroll in June, if we didn't have access to additional funds, we would not be able to cover this budget. So as we talked before, our district is very reliant on property tax for our revenue. And property taxes don't come in until April. And so it goes a long stretch of receiving large payments in January, February, April, and then we get June, August, September area. And we go a long drought period without getting any revenue. And so a few years ago, we moved from borrowing on a year basis to doing a line of credit, so that we were only accessing those funds at the time that we needed it, and then the following year. And what that has done for us is to reduce the amount of interest that we pay.